Welcome. I'm really glad that you are joining us this week online, whether it's through Rogers Cable, whether it's through YouTube, whether it's through Facebook. We're just glad that you're connecting with us here today. My name is Joel, and I am the pastor of Paris Community Church. And if this is your very first time watching, one of the things that we really value is community. Not only building community, but also caring for our community. And through the summer, we continue to see this happen. We just wrapped up an outreach for our community in terms of providing back to school supplies for families in need. And so for those of you that drop things off at the church, thank you so much. That is going to be such a benefit to people within our community. We've also run now 4 weeks of kids summer camp programs. We still have two more weeks left. And so if you know kids who might be interested, who might want to spend another week at camp, jump on our website and check it out. We have a lot of things that continue to happen. And so if you haven't yet signed up for eBlast, please go over to our website, click on the button there, and learn more about all the various things that are happening. Because we're getting closer and closer to September when a number of our groups begin to launch and kick off. And so I want to talk about two things real quickly that's still an opportunity for you to join in on. If you live in the Paris area, we're having our last backyard campfire August 25th, 6:30 p.m. at my house. It's a chance to hang out, play games, get to know new people, roast some sugar, just have a great time together. And so we'd love for you to join us. Just bring a camp chair, bring someone else. The second thing is starting in September, we're going to be running the Alpha Series video film series. And it's a great way where if you have questions about faith, if you have questions about life, this is a great opportunity to begin to jump in to look at how does life and faith begin to intersect. Again, there's going to be more information on our website. We're going to be talking about it more and more. But maybe this is an opportunity for you to come and to learn one-on-one with others about what does it look like for God to be a part of your everyday. We're gonna show a quick video about Alpha before we jump into the rest of the service. But hey, thanks for joining us here today. We hope that today helps you encounter more of God in the midst of your life.
Life moves fast, doesn't it? Every day there is so much to fit in. But do you ever stop and think? What's the point of it all? Do you ever ask yourself, is there more to life than this? Alpha is a series of sessions exploring life, faith, and meaning. It's a space to explore the big questions, to say what you think, and hear other people's points of view. First up, there's food, then a talk, followed by a discussion. Each talk explores a different aspect of the Christian faith. And then in a small group, you get to say exactly what you think. The aim of the talk is to spark conversation, each week unpacking a different question. There's no obligation to say anything, and there's nothing you can't say. Seriously. An opportunity to hear from others and contribute your own perspective in an honest, friendly, and open environment. Why not try it out?
Jesus, we are here. Jesus, we are here, we're here for you. Sweet. We've gathered in this place to honor you, to worship you in spirit and in truth. Oh Jesus, we are here, we're here for you. We're here for you.
Hi, my name is Ryan. I'm a member of the Paris Community Church community, and I'm looking forward to exploring Psalm 55 with you today. Now, the Psalms, if you're not really familiar with them, are something that our church has been working through all summer, and they're these ancient songs or poems from the Old Testament part of the Bible, many of them written by David, who was a king in the Old Testament. They're beloved and special for a lot of reasons, but in large part because they really covered the breadth of human experience and give words to people who sometimes struggle to find words to express what they're experiencing in life. Kind of makes me think of a recent film. In 2015, the film Inside Out came out. If you've seen it, you know it's lots of fun. There are these cute little cartoon emotions representing all the different emotions inside a child. Joy, anger, disgust, sadness, and fear. And of course, that's not all the emotions somebody can feel. So this year, they came out with a sequel that I watched with my kids a few weeks ago, where they added some new ones as the main character in the movie becomes a teenager. They added embarrassment, envy, ennui or boredom, and anxiety. My favorite new character was Nostalgia, though, this little old lady who keeps showing up at the most inopportune times in the movie, and they keep sending her away saying, "You're too early, she's only 13. Well, the film's trying to cover the range of emotions that we experience in life in an art form, to express with art what people often struggle to say with their own words. Not unlike what David and others were trying to do when they wrote Psalms so many years ago. And when we think about the Psalms, we often think first of the more familiar ones, the happy ones, like joyful ascents up a hill to go and worship God, or the really familiar ones, even if they're a bit sad, like walking through the valley of the shadow of death. It'd be easy to skip over some of the angry Psalms, but they're there. They're an important part of the wide range of human emotions and experiences that are in the Psalms. Joel tackled one a couple weeks ago, and I will too today, but from a different angle, because they're each a little different. Here's how Psalm 55 starts, in the voice of David, the complicated but painfully human king of Israel. "Listen to my prayer, O God. Do not ignore my plea. Hear me and answer me. My thoughts trouble me, and I am distraught because of what my enemies sang, because of the threats of the wicked, for they bring down suffering on me and assail me in their anger. My heart is in anguish within me. The terrors of death have fallen on me. Fear and trembling have beset me. Horror has overwhelmed me. I said, 'Oh, that I had the wings of a dove, I'd fly away and be at rest. I would flee far away and stay in the desert. I would hurry to my place of shelter far from the tempest and storm.' Lord, confuse the wicked. Confound their words, for I see violence and strife in the city. Day and night they prowl about on its walls, malice and abuse are within it. Destructive forces are at work in the city, threats and lies never leave its streets." Well, we'll pause there just after verse 11. This part's probably familiar to many of us. We might not use quite as flowery language or as powerful language as that, but we can look at the world around us, many of us, and see lots of good, but also lots of things wrong. Close by or far away, we can see when things just aren't quite right. Whether it's wildfires, wars, pandemics, crimes, and more, we can see big problems in the world around us that show something's wrong with our world at large. Something's wrong with us, humans. These are all signs of what the Bible calls sin. That even though God created a good and wonderful world for us to live in, and to know Him in, and to have a close relationship with Him in, we humans started to act more like our own gods, our own creators, rather than the creations of the one true God. This affected humans, separating us from God, but also the whole world around us, leading to all the ways we just listed off that the world isn't quite what God created today, but rather a broken form of what he created. David saw this too. As a king, he was charged with defending his country's interests, economic, military, political, all of it. Lots of forces were aligned against him as he did that, and against his country, all results of sin, human rebellion against God that's left our world broken. David tells us a few of the things about his reaction to such trouble, and it's a journey through three stages that might sound familiar to some of us. Because it starts with some internal anguish, with troubling thoughts, with anxiety, with crying out to God and suffering internally. But then he starts to say, I just want to run away from it all. Whether it's the wings of a dove fleeing far away in the desert or finding a shelter from a storm, whether he has to fly, run, or sail away, it all sounds good to him to just get away and forget his troubles. And then finally he gets angry and asks God to attack his enemies on his behalf. They're wicked, confuse their words. Don't let them get away with this. It's essentially what he's saying to God. He moves from anxiety to fear to anger. All natural enough ways that we broken humans react to trouble around us, to sin. But what happens, what matters, is not just our raw reactions, but where we go from there, where they lead us to. Whether they lead us to more despair, more fear, more anxiety, more anger, or whether they lead us to a place of trust. Thankfully, that's the case with David. There's more to the story than what we've heard so far. His trouble isn't just a distant king conspiring to attack his country. He can't just blame a worshiper of other gods or a natural enemy of Israel. Nor is it just some unfortunate impersonal circumstance he's facing, like a drought killing his crops or a virus making people sick. No, this is personal. His problems are deeper than that. If we read on in Psalm 55, starting at verse 12, we hear, if an enemy were insulting me, I could endure it. If a foe were rising against me, I could hide. But it is you, a man like myself, my companion, my close friend, with whom I once enjoyed sweet fellowship at the house of God as we walked among worshippers. Let death take my enemies by surprise. Let them go down alive to the realm of the dead, for evil finds lodging among them. See, the source of his trouble is someone just like him. He's been betrayed by someone who's a companion, a close friend, even family, a Jewish man who worshipped alongside him at the temple. The challenge here is that his problems are not so easily dismissed as coming from some hated other, an enemy, but it comes from someone close, someone just like him. That means it hurts all the more, and it also means that he needs to acknowledge that there's something wrong not just with other people, but with people just like him. There's something wrong with humans. Now, in David's story, this was likely his son, Absalom, who'd been conspiring to take his throne and rising up an army to overthrow him. David's lamenting his betrayal, not just by some distant enemy, but by a son whom he loved, and yet who rejected him. And this kind of betrayal can be relevant to our daily lives too. When we face betrayal, frustration, and anger as well, in all kinds of relationships, both the ones far, far away that are easy to detach ourselves from, and the ones that are close by, in families, in friendships, in communities, in workplaces, in schools, in churches, even. Everywhere that people are found, they can be tempted to be self-serving, greedy, and abusive. People continue to betray one another and abuse the trust of others. It affects us all. And what makes Christians different, though, is our response. There's a but. There's a but in David's story. There's a but possible in our stories, too, where we can be hurt and betrayed, but deal with it differently. Whereas David puts it in the psalm, an as for me. Here's what he says in verse 16 of Psalm 55. As for me, I call to God, and the Lord saves me. Evening, morning, and noon, I cry out in distress, and he hears my voice. He rescues me unharmed from the battle waged against me, even though many oppose me. All this trouble, anxiety, fear, anger, it all leads him to a turning point, thank goodness, where he says, as for me, I'm going to do something different. David didn't just say this. He actually chose not to murder his son when he had the chance, but allowed him to live despite his betrayal. He didn't let anger, fear, or anxiety drive him. Instead, he moved through those things to trust God and wrote about it in this psalm for us to learn from. To show us the answer isn't to just internalize our troubles and see nothing but trouble and lose sight of any hope and just fall further into despair. He showed us that our solution isn't to hide from our troubles, that Christians who just try to separate themselves from the world's troubles end up not really being able to do much about them to make the world a better place, to be salt and light like Christians are called to be. And that we're not called to just rage against trouble. When Christians try to use the world's tools to make change happen, like political power, like violence, we become part of the problem, not part of the solution. This is something that my family even tries to put into practice at home, where we try to have real frank discussions about the world as it is, the things we agree with and the things we don't agree with, the saints and the sinners, the behaviors, the language, the explicit material, the violence, and more. It's all there in the world around us, and we're foolish to pretend it isn't. The world, amazingly, is all at the same time a beautiful place because God created it and loves us, and also a broken place, because we humans have turned against God in sin and taken the rest of the world with us. But we try to trust in God for our salvation, not despairing, not just running away, not just raging against it, but rather trusting in God. Now, it's important to pause for a moment and just say that trusting in God doesn't mean any Christian should ignore or tolerate abuse, whether it's physical, sexual, emotional, or otherwise. Someone who reports, escapes, or works to end such crimes is not someone who lacks trust in God and should have just toughed it out, but someone whose trust in God is driving them to do a difficult but really important thing. So if that's a situation that describes you, the first step is to find safety. Not to just say, I'll endure it because I trust God, but rather to say, I'll find safety and from there, trust God. I trust God so much, I know I can get the help I need. Through a trusted friend, pastor, police, professional, institution, sometimes all at the same time. Whatever it might be, I'd encourage you to reach out to whomever you can to get help if that situation describes you. Trusting God is something that happens throughout this process, not something that stands in the way of someone getting help. Trusting in God is not instead of physical or mental safety, but part of what equips a person to pursue it, and part of what results from pursuing it. And then from that place of safety, we can say, but as for us, we will call to God for help, for guidance, for hope. The solution is to turn to God and live in His way, even if others don't. Like David says in verse 16, as for me, I call to God, and the Lord saves me. This is David pointing towards Jesus. Hundreds of years before Jesus Christ walked on this earth, the Son of God became a human and walked on this earth with us. Hundreds of years before that, David was already proclaiming his trust in God's salvation, that God would somehow, someday, save him from himself, and he didn't need to save himself. Even hundreds of years earlier, David was aware that God would come to our broken, sinful world and show us a different way of life that Jesus called the kingdom of God, where he took the sin and brokenness on each of us and our entire world, all onto himself, and brought it to his death on the cross. Sin that would have led to our eternal death otherwise, instead is something he took on himself and allowed it to become part of his death instead of ours. And then when he rose from the dead, he made it possible for us to be saved from our sin, from our problems, from our trouble with sin, in order to call on God and trust in him and let him take the problems of the world on himself rather than ourselves. Even though this psalm was written hundreds of years before, it was already pointing forwards to Jesus and calling us to put our trust in him, not in ourselves, to trust God over our anxieties, our fears, and our anger, and to hand it over. David was also giving us a taste of what Jesus would be like, as his words of trust in God were foreshadowing Jesus' own final words and actions. As Jesus was heading towards the cross, after all his anguish over his impending execution, to the point of shedding tears of blood, he hands it over to God knowing that he can trust his Father even when he's facing the most difficult and dangerous moment of his life, by saying at the end of his prayer for God to deliver him if there's some way possible, "But not my will, but yours." He's willing to trust God even in those difficult, painful circumstances where he expresses with his words what he really, truly wants to be delivered from it. He doesn't want to have to go through it, but is willing at the end to exhale and ask God to take control, putting his trust in God. We also find it in Jesus' Lord's Prayer, where he says, "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Even after asking for the things he needs, like daily bread, Jesus hands it over and teaches us to hand it over and to say, after all that we've asked for all that we need, for all that we want, the best way to end our prayers is simply to say, "Thy will be done. I trust you, God." I used to teach a course where we included a section on how to pray. It was a course on Christian basics, similar to the Alpha course that is running here at PCC later this year. And people would always ask, "Well, how does prayer work? What if I pray for something God doesn't want?" At worst, they were thinking, "Well, what if I'm praying death and vengeance on someone, like we see in the psalm here? Or at its best, what if I'm just praying for sunny weather when the farmers really need rain? Do I need to know exactly what God wants before I can pray? What happens if I pray for something outside of God's plan?" We see examples of that in David's story, where he's praying for something that he might actually regret, and then is willing at the end to just say, "But I trust God. As for me, I'll trust God. I know what my anger wants. I know what my fear wants. I know what my anxieties want. But I also know I need to trust God in this." We see it in Jesus. Same thing as he approaches his moment of execution. He's asking God if he can be delivered, but then exhales and says, "But thy will be done. Not my will, but yours." I asked this kind of question myself when I was working as a hospital chaplain, where I asked my supervisor, "What do I do if I'm asked to pray for someone to be healed and the doctor just told me they had hours to live? Do we pray for a miracle or not?" And I've always remembered what my supervisor said. Really, all we can do is tell God what we want and what we need, and do our best to express what we think he would want. In our human frailty, we can ask for what we think is best, but then at the end, to end it with trust, saying something like, "Jesus's, yet not my will, but yours." We see this in all kinds of different expressions. Anybody involved in Alcoholics Anonymous knows the idea of let go and let God. Or anybody familiar with country music knows, "Jesus, take the wheel." So whichever way you prefer to say it, the message is the same. Now, it's not always easy. Even David, who's writing the psalm, kind of struggles with this. And after all he said here about his anger, his anxieties, his fear, and yet how he's going to trust God through it, he still needs to get in one more angry jab at the bad guys and make sure God knows they're bad guys, and his enemy in particular. Here's what he says in verse 19. "God, who's enthroned from of old, who does not change, he will hear them and humble them because they have no fear of God. My companion attacks his friends. He violates his covenant. His talk is smooth as butter, yet war is in his heart. His words are more soothing than oil, yet they are drawn swords." Here he's calling out one more time to God, just to be sure that he heard him. "You need to know God. He's really a bad guy. He's a smooth talker, but he's a liar. He's not a good friend. He doesn't fear God. He's all kinds of wrong. You need to know that. Now I'll trust you. Now that I know you know, and I've said all I need to say, I'll trust you, God." And I think here David's showing us, too, that it's just okay to flip-flop a little bit, to struggle, to not get it right the first time, to still struggle with that anger, that anxiety, that fear, and yet still be trusting. To be angry yet trusting, to be ready to hide from it all and run away yet trusting, to be anxious yet trusting. He illustrates that there's a fine line to walk between calling injustice what it is and preventing further injustice, not tolerating abuse and becoming passive or victims, and yet trusting God, being people of forgiveness and peace. Even Jesus' famous turn the other cheek command wasn't just passive, but an act of defiance and trust. And so even after his last little struggle with all these anxieties, fears, and anger, David ends his psalm beginning in verse 22 with a final turn to God. Cast your cares on the Lord, and he will sustain you. He will never let the righteous be shaken. But you, God, will bring down the wicked into the pit of decay. The bloodthirsty and deceitful will not live out their days. But as for me, I trust in you. There's the point of it all again. Exhale. As for me, I trust in God. Yes, there's wickedness, anger, violence, hatred, evil, and death in this world. And it can be all-consuming if we try to deal with it ourselves by internally stewing about it in anxiety, by hiding from it and trying to run away out of fear, or by raging against it using evil to fight evil, like with anger. And even if we start here, as Christians, we're called to end elsewhere, to say, as for me, I trust in God to do the right thing. I trust in God to get vengeance if that's what this situation calls for, to seek justice and make justice happen if that's what this calls for. I'll trust in God. I don't need to do this myself. Even when it's hard and when we, like David, flip-flop back and forth between calling down vengeance and just taking a breath before trusting God once again. See, this isn't a test, some kind of a thing you have to do to get into heaven. Rather, it's a practice to learn as the Holy Spirit works on us and tries to transform our hearts to be more and more like Jesus. To be more and more like what David was pointing towards as he described Jesus even hundreds of years before as the one who would save him from his own struggles to try to do all these things themselves, but instead to trust in God. It's not a test, it's a practice to learn, to trust God even when we're anxious, afraid, and angry, even in a sinful, broken world. So let's do some practice now. I'm sure there's some situation you're facing, think of one, where someone's betrayed you. Whether it's somebody close, like a family, friend, colleague, church member, or whether it's one of the world's bigger problems that you're frustrated with, that you know is wrong, and yet it feels so much bigger than yourself. We all have our sort of default reactions. What's yours? Is it to stew about it? To be consumed by anxiety? Is it to just want to run away from it all and get away? Is it to rage against it in anger? Well, we'll take a chance now to just name it for what it is. To try to prevent further betrayal, yes, but then to just give it to God. And I think that starts with prayer, with just asking God for help. Like David's psalm, was him asking for that help, to trust in God instead of himself, no matter what trouble he was facing. And in the same way that Jesus' final prayer to God was to let his will be done. So we'll practice this now too, with prayer. So let's pray. Just take a moment, close your eyes, think of what that situation is. Lord, we come to you with all kinds of different situations we're facing that can be hurting, that can be hard, that can be angering. Help us to call these situations what they are, sin. Help us never to tolerate abuse or accept it, but rather show us where we can find safety so no further harm is done. And from that safe place, help us learn to trust you, to hand over these troubles to you, to give you our hurts, our anger, our confusion, not to try to solve them ourselves by just thinking about it nonstop, becoming anxious, or by hiding and running away, or by raging against them, using the world's tools to try to just fix things ourselves. Instead, help us know we can trust you. We can trust you to do the right thing, to bring justice in the big picture, if not in this moment. Help us to love you enough, to trust you enough, to hand over these troubles to you, knowing that you can take care of them, that you will save us, and that you are actively saving the world from our collective problem with sin whether we're seeing it in the big picture or in our very own lives and in our very own circles. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
The king who conquered the grave. What is the